What's up, everybody? On today's episode of the Hashtag Blackout Podcast, we give you our Christmas movie countdown, our 25 favorite Christmas movies to keep you and get you in the holiday season. We also have a few voicemails to listen to, some things that make you go hmm, and a holiday tap your love box. All this and more on today's episode of the Hashtag Blackout Podcast. Blah, 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 blah.
They told me pa-ra-pa-pam-pam, a newborn king to see pa-ra-pa-pam-pam.
What's up, everybody? Welcome back to episode 74 of the Hashtag Blackout Podcast. I'm Jared.
I'm Jay.
And we backing at it again. Jay, funny talking to you, what, 2 days later, huh?
2 days later, Dilla. Weird.
How was your last 2 days?
Last 2 days were insane.
Yeah.
Chuck E. Cheese. Mm-hmm. That's all parents need to know to relate insanity to Chuck E. Cheese. So yeah. Yeah, I did that. Kid had a birthday party. Mm-hmm. Not even a birthday party. Just took him out for his birthday because he loves Chuck E. Cheese. Did that. And then, of course, later that night, he came down with a fever. And then today we take him to the doctor. Hey, what do you know? It's the flu.
The flizzoo. Wow.
It's flizzoo, man. You know, and it's crazy because I was like, I text my wife and I'm like, next year we're not even doing a flu shot. Screw that.
Yeah.
You know, we did one this year and he still came down with the flu.
Yeah, that's crazy. That's so sad.
I mean, if any doctor or pediatric nurse or whoever is out there that listens to this show, or any nurse period, somebody please explain to me why my kid still gets the flu even though he gets a flu shot. I know there's different strains, mm-hmm. of course I know that, but why are we even getting the flu shot period
if we still gonna catch it, huh?
Yeah, if we still gonna catch it.
It doesn't make much sense to me either.
No, my parents didn't give me a flu shot when I was growing up.
Oh, they didn't have it that then, though.
Yeah, I didn't get a flu shot until I was maybe, 26 or 27, and that was only because my job was giving away free flu shots. Mm-hmm. So I was just like, may as well go ahead and get it. My parents always keep bugging me about getting a flu shot every year, but, you know, I don't want to do it. I didn't do it this year. I didn't do it last year or the year before, so,
yeah.
You know.
They
cross
say
my
if
fingers.
You go get it, you got to go ahead and try to get it before, you know, before it gets too deep into the season. You know what I'm saying? Before that first real bad cold snap happens or something like that, you know, because that's normally when it happens. And then also when people just be coughing all out all over the place and not washing their hands.
And touching stuff.
That's really
and I be, say. You know, and sometimes I'll be thinking these doctors be diagnosing that flu wrong because last year I had like a really bad sinus infection. Mm-hmm. I went to the doctor. They did the whole little nose swab and tested it out. Came back positive for flu. I paid $100+ for some Tamiflu. Mm-hmm. And then the very next day, didn't even start taking the Tamiflu. Still in my medicine cabinet in the box.
Yeah.
Didn't even take it. Next day, I felt 100% better.
What?
No shot, no anything.
No, nothing.
I told him I thought it was just a sinus infection. Just give me some meds for sinuses or something like that. But no, they said it was the flu. Prescribed Tamiflu. Paid $100 for that. Next day felt better.
You know, I mean, I know that the doctors and nurses and whoever listens to our show can speak to this, but I think it's crazy because the flu can look like, you know, the flu can look like a stomach bug. It can look like a sinus infection, an upper respiratory. But you know, there's some more telltale signs, you know, that really tell you that it's the flu. But yeah, that's crazy that they, you know, misdiagnosed you, and you were fine just right after that. You know, that's crazy. But I don't know, man. I think some of these immunizations are a racket. You know what I'm saying? I can't tell. You know, especially the ones that they do for kids, because some of them, you know, they they seem like they work. Some of them, you know, seem like they're just giving a shot just to give them a shot. You know, sometimes it seems like they don't work. You know, and immunizations like the flu shot, you know, are one of those things as well. So,
yeah.
I don't know. I have friends and family on both sides of the coin who like them, you know, who like to get their kids shots and don't.
Yeah,
you know?
Swear by the flu, man. You know, they swear by that flu shot. You know, and last year I got my other son flu shot, and then he caught the flu twice.
Man. I mean,
so
explain that. But then again, you know, I know it's one of those things. Some people body chemistry don't work with it. And like you said, there's different strains. Sure. So who even knows? You know what I'm saying? Like, I guess the doctors don't even know, you know, based on your story.
It's like, let's just put this dead virus in you just to test it out.
Let's see what's going to happen.
Yeah.
Test it on all
experiment.
These.
Experiment. And then on top of all this, I got a freaking ant infestation in my house.
Oh, yeah.
That's never
good. Texas weather is changing on you, isn't it?
Dude, it was like 70-some degrees one day, 40-some degrees the next day, 60-some the next day, then it drops down to 30-some. So, you know, schizophrenic weather, bipolar weather we got here.
That sounds like Texas. And, you know, when all I know is this. When you start to see those ants start to march through your house, because they had like an ant super highway that went through my house. Two or three different directions. I would always see them suckers going through there and had to put down the stuff to kill them, you know, or divert them. And I just know that when that happens, there's a couple things. Either it's about to get cold or it's about to get hot again, or you know, it's raining a lot outside and they're trying to find a dry place. So, man, I'm telling you, man, you know, that sucks. But I'm going to have to tell you off the show, but... No, I'll tell you right now. The taro ant baits, T-E-R-R-O ant baits, are like orange and black. You can find them at Home Depot. They look like liquid. I'm telling you, man, them thing work like a charm. It takes a couple days because, and it looks really crazy because basically you have like an ant colony all like running in and out of that ant bait trap. But basically what they do, they take that liquid back to their queen and it kills the queen and it kills all the ants. So, you know.
But the crazy thing is, man, they're like coming from everywhere. It's like they're in my kitchen.
Yeah.
And then they coming out my wall socket, the electrical socket. I'm like, what the hell? And I'll go in my kid's closet tonight. I see them fools like made like a little hole, like right at the corner of the ceiling. And they're like peeking through in there. And I'm like, come on, dude. I can't have all this.
That's
not now.
Crazy. Well,
because I'm going to leave for Christmas and come back and they're going to be chilling in my house watching my TV.
Yes. Eating all your popcorn.
For real, right?
Mad that they're out of milk. I probably have a recommendation for pest control if you want. And he actually did a really good job on our house when it came to ants. So I don't know if you have enough time to get him out there before you leave for the holidays. But, you know, maybe just maybe. So I'll have to send you that dude's information. He was good, and he was pretty consistent. So he's the one who did the bees at my house.
Okay.
He did the ants. He did the bees. He did some wasps. So the dude was good. Anyway, yeah, enough of that foolishness. Sad that your little kiddo is not feeling well. Same with mine today. You know, he was supposed to do the last two performances of his Christmas play. Came down with some kind of stomach bug out of the middle of nowhere. So sad for him, but... Yeah, he's laying around all day long talking about, I feel like I'm going to die. You know, I'm like, dude, you just need some fluids, but you can't hold on to fluids. So I don't know what happened because, you know, we pretty much ate the same stuff at the same places the last couple days. It's just something that happened. So, you know, for all you people out there, wash your hands. You coughing, you sneezing, wash your hands. Make sure your kids wash their hands, you know, because it could be anything. It could have been after his basketball game yesterday if he didn't wash his hands. I don't know. I don't know. It's just foolishness. But on the positive note, basketball. So the first two games, Jackson fouled out.
Like, oh, straight damn.
Up. First game, he fouled out in like 5 minutes. I was like, my man, you gotta just play smarter. Second game, it took him till the fourth quarter, but he fouled out. But he played a little smarter. You know, he had better defense, you know.
This
last game, he only had two fouls, he had a couple steals, you know, had a couple rebounds. He did well this time. So he would be the pesky defender, you know, at this point, not scoring a lot, just defending. So
he's like the Dennis Rodman of the He's a little rough.
He's a Rodman. He's a little Patrick Beverly. You know, he's out there all up in your kitchen. You know what I'm saying? Making all the kids look at him like, why are you all up on me? He's like, I'm just here to take the ball. That's it. So, yeah, so shout out to him for that.
It's like forget scoring.
yeah. It's funny. He's like, screw that. It's like, I'll catch the ball and let it get stolen from me. It's all right. I'll just come back and steal it. So I'm going to have to teach him how to be stronger with the ball. So go up strong with the ball. So anyway, so shout out to his little basketball team. So whatever. But now, let's just go and get into this episode. So,
yeah, let's just get into it.
Man, this is like the Christmas episode. This is like our holiday episode. You know, we throughout the month we've been dropping the 25 movie days of Christmas on our Instagram and Twitter. And yeah, you know, we've been listing a bunch of movies throughout the month that we love. You know, our 25 favorite movies of the holiday season. So, you know, we're going to get to that list. Excuse me, here in a minute, but in the meantime, before we do that, we have some voicemails. We got some Google voicemails. So, Jay, why don't you go ahead and tell the people how they can reach us on the voicemail?
All right, everybody, you can reach us at 385-3BL-AKPC. That's 385-325-2572. Call us and leave us some well wishes for the new year or some Merry Christmases or something.
Merry what?
Merry Christmases.
How many Merry Christmases is that?
I don't know. It's a bunch of Merry Christmases. It's plural.
That's funny.
Okay.
So here we go. So we have two voicemails today. I'm going to go ahead and get this first one cracking in 3, 2, 1.
Y'all seen all the memes about me on the internet, man. About me saying, man. Can you imagine the Marvel Universe with Terrence Howard in it, man? I would have been War Machine, man. Just like that. It would have been War Machine, man. Man, me and Don Cheadle were going to have a motherfucking fight, man. And, man, what's up? This your boy, B-Rob. No, I ain't been leaving you the voicemails. Probably because I was on the motherfucking show, you. We didn't do podcast inception this time, but, yeah, so, I don't know, I'm on the way back from Victoria, Texas, heading back to H-Time, and I felt compelled to call you after listening to your latest episode. Also, the giveaway is over. Kayla, you were too late, I'm sorry. Nathan Wallaston won the giveaway. It was artist, former guest of the show, Anomaly. He got a new album out called Revelations. It's his last solo album, but he'll continue to make music with his group, Infamous Society, which consists of him, Mr. Catastrophic, and a dude named Rad that I never talked to yet, that don't know how to work his Twitter or Instagram, to get back at me so we can do that interview. So I can interview all three of them. They have the Infamous Society as a group on the show, but that's a whole nother thing. Man, Terrence got something that he wants to tell y'all. Put some hooks, rubs, and spices on your lady friend titties, man. We blacking out.
Oh, man. Well, thanks, Terrence Howard and B-Rob, for the messages.
Damn. He got to get that collab going, too.
Yeah.
B-Rob been collabing with everybody.
It's crazy. He's got every single person on the show. Randomness. Not the fun thing about B-Rob. If you haven't listened to the Random Ramblings with Rob podcast, you should definitely go check it out. Go to like randomrobcast.com and find him. He's there, as well as a lot of other places. But you know what's funny about him is he'll just straight up, you know, just see something interesting on Instagram or Twitter. Somebody interesting or something like that, or YouTube, and he'll just shoot him an email or, you know, send him a direct message, say, hey, I'd love to have you on the show sometime. And they're like, all right, bet, let's make it happen. And then there you go. Next thing you know, they're on the show. So it's pretty crazy how that works out, but yeah, that's what I love about his show, the fact that he is sort of fearless when it comes to just sending somebody a message and finding out. And yeah, I guess Terrence Howard has some hooks, rubs, and spices he liked to put on his lady friends, so that's dope.
Yes, indeed.
That's dope. All right, cool. Let's see. Well, looks like we have another voicemail.
My stomach hurt. My cheeks hurt. Not my butt cheeks. My face cheeks.
What?
I just finished the episode, and y'all read off all the damn Terrence Howard memes and shit, which was extra funny to me because I left the previous voicemail not even getting to that part yet. Not even knowing that y'all was going to talk about Terrence Howard. And Terrence Howard just so happened to be in the call with me, and we called in, man. Ain't that some crazy shit? That's some crazy shit, ain't it?
That's great. He didn't even
know. That's great.
Yeah, that was about 2 hours later, so I guess he finally listened to that. That's pretty funny. All right, cool. Well, thanks, B-Rob, for that. I think Jay and I need to leave you some extra special silly voicemails. Maybe we need to reach out to our boys 26 and 27 Savage to see if they can get, rap on your voicemail for you. Anyway, all right, cool. Well, thanks for the voicemails, B-Rob. Anybody else out there, please send them in. Kayla, I know you're listening while you sit there and wait for the UPS drivers and the FedEx man and the mailman and the vending machine dude. The guy that's coming to fix the copy machine, the pizza boy, pizza man, homeboy who's going to come over and try to get that pest out of your attic. I know you're sitting there listening to us while you're waiting for all of those people. So, Kayla, holla at us, all right? Holla at us. And while we wait for Kayla, we're going to go ahead and tell you guys about some of our favorite holiday movies. We're going to just run down from 25 to 1.
25 to 1.
Yeah, and the order is sort of fudged up. It's in some points, I think, just because some of them, you know, may be tied with others, but, you know, whatever.
No, yeah, and you know, we were just naming off stuff that we liked. I mean, it's not concrete as to if they were the number one best show or movie ever, but, you know, just some things that we like. So hopefully you guys enjoy it. We'll run them down. We'll start at number 25.
Go for it.
Number 25 was The Night Before.
I never watched that.
It was actually a pretty good show. It was a pretty good movie. It came out in 2017, 2016, I believe. 2016 or 2015. But, you know, it stars Seth Rogen and Anthony Mackie and I can't think of his name.
My guy who plays in Gotham. He plays Joseph Gordon-Levitt.
There you go, Joseph Gordon-Levitt. Why can't I always? I was about to call him something else. Yeah, but anyway, those three. But yeah, it was a pretty good movie. They're like best friends, and they get one last Christmas together. They've been spending Christmases together for like the longest time, so they get one last Christmas together before everybody just goes their own way and grows up. But yeah, turned out to be a decent movie. So yeah, that was number 25.
All right, cool. What was number 24 then?
24 was Office Christmas Party.
Also a movie I didn't see.
Oh, man. Y'all and your company seem like it would be the type to have an office Christmas party like this.
Yeah, because we're laid back like that.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah, I mean, our Christmas party was pretty dope. It was actually this past weekend. I was the MC, the DJ.
Did y'all have, like, tequila in the water coolers?
We did not have tequila in the water coolers, which would have been super dope. But what we did have was a game called Twerk for No Work. Yes, you heard it. Twerk for No Work. Wow. And we actually had that game that started last year, and I participated. I did not win the twerk off. But essentially what we have
is,
I mean, hey, you know, what we have is tissue boxes that we fill up with ping pong balls, right? Take all the tissues out, put ping pong balls in them, and get a little ribbon and tie it around people's waists. And I think they had like 10 people in the twerk off this year. And essentially, everybody does the twerk dance or shakes their butt or whatever, you know what I'm saying, until they get all the ping pong balls out. And whoever empties their box of ping pong balls first gets a free paid day off. So if you're salaried, add a PTO day to your PTO. If you're non-salaried, they just pay you for a day off.
Wow,
pretty dope, huh?
Yeah, so many lawsuits at my job, but yeah, cool.
Yeah. You know, we thought it was a little weird, and
all especially that calling ethics it, training calling it twerk. That I be doing.
I mean, you know, we got it cleared through the higher ups, so you know, this is one of those things. I mean, it's on video. Somebody videotaped it, and you know, and posted it on their phone. I don't know where it's posted.
Were there some memorable twerks?
There might have been, but I can't speak on these types of things.
Okay.
In this day and age of sexual harassment allegations, I can't speak on these type of things.
All right. Good answer.
Let's just say that it was interesting. The winner was a female.
I would hope so.
There were guys and women in the twerk off, but yeah, the winner was a female this time.
What song did you play?
Man, it was so okay. So the guy who was the DJ actually getting music, for the holiday music or whatever, Christmas music. I asked him just to go on Spotify and just find like some booty trap music or something like that. I was just like, find a trap instrumental. Tell me why he's trying to start spelling instrumental with an E.
Whoa. For real? Wow.
Dude, sorry. He was like, E. I was like,
and this guy works at your job?
Yeah, yes. I was like, instrumental.
In the shipping department, probably, right?
Possibly. I was like, instrumental. And homeboy was like, E-N-T. Yeah. I was like, my guy, I-N-S. And he's like, oh, okay, yeah. So he found some instrumentals. And like, it was just like some really slow, like R&B. And I was like, this is not going to work. And then what happened? Somebody was like, just play Jump Around. And so,
of course.
So he even tried to type in Jump Around. And I was I was like, just type in House of Pain. And he's like, H O S. I was like, oh, dog, come on. Just give me the phone. So we finally got it on. Yeah, so we played Jump Around. But it was good, man. It was good. It lasted for about 30 seconds. So it was a pretty good party. You know, the twerk off. Twerk for no work. I was going to say, like, if they wanted to change the name, if they made us change the name, we'd just call it, like, Shake for No Shift. But twerk for no work run out, man.
All right.
Twerk
for no work. That'll work.
Anyway, back to Office Christmas Party. So it sounded like a fun movie. I'm sure I could find that on some free movie site, can't I?
Yeah, man. Yeah. Oh yeah. I'm sure you can find it. But I just have to say, Jennifer Aniston gets like more and more fine with age.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. She always been. But I think you're right, man. She's like a fine wine.
She is. All right. Next up, what we got?
Next up, Lethal Weapon. Lethal Weapon. So, Lethal Weapon. Back in the day. With Mel Gibson before everybody thought he was racist, and Danny Glover, which has now turned into a new Fox TV series, sadly.
It has. And, you know, we actually watch it quite a bit.
Is it funny, though?
It's, you know, Damon Wayans and the other guy, I can't think of his name now, but they do a decent job Murtaugh and Riggs, so you know I can't complain. It's not like the exact same stuff that went on in the movies, but this will have to be probably like a separate talk because it could get too long. But yeah, it's decent. It's a decent take on the movie.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I don't know. Maybe I'll watch it one day. Maybe not. I don't know. But Lethal Weapon, great movie. I believe it didn't it release during Christmas time? Is that why we consider it a Christmas movie? I can't even remember.
When did it? I don't remember. I honestly don't remember.
March 1987, so no. Not in Christmas movies.
We just dropped a whole bunch of stuff.
We just liked it in Christmas. People like there to watch go. It during Christmas time. I don't
Nobody
know.
Nobody cares. There we go.
Nobody cares. Mel Gibson's getting a second chance right now. Danny Glover still hadn't necessarily got his second chance yet, but hopefully he'll be back. hopefully. All right, let's see here. Next after Lethal Weapon, Jingle All the Way
with Sinbad Arnold.
And Arnold.
And a spoiled-ass, privileged little kid.
Man.
Wanting a Turbo Man. Mm-hmm. This man goes his whole time, the whole movie, trying to find a freaking doll for his kid. You know, that's what I call some good parents, man. And, of course, we get a guest appearance by Sinbad. He played the postman, eventually turning into quote-unquote bad guy. But, you know, if you didn't see it, it's a nice little fun holiday movie.
Yep, Jingle Kids All the Way from 96, dang.
1996, goodness. Yeah.
I mean, they had Arnold, had Sinbad, Phil Hartman,
yep.
Man, Rita Wilson, Jim Belushi was in that. There's a lot of good actors in that, so... yeah, it was a great. Richard Mall was in it. It was a great movie. And I mean, every parent's story. If you're not a parent, this is what your parents did for you when you were younger, when you were kids, trying to go and find that special gift for you. You know, capitalization at its finest. You know, buy, find this one gift. And you know, there was a year. You know, that year that Toy Story came out, and all those toys were super popping and popular. I mean, when the Cars movies, I mean, you know, there's so many every year. Like this year, it will definitely be Star Wars stuff.
Yep. And what is that? Why am I drawing a blank, man? I don't know why.
Is it a toy we talked about last week?
No, it's not a toy we talked about, but it's some things my son loves. Gecko. What is that? Let's just scratch this part because I can't even think of the name of the thing. But anyway, one of the toys was like sold out, but all the other characters were still on the shelf.
Okay.
It's like nobody liked those characters, but we'll buy this one character.
So, that's funny. Is it one of those like live toys? Or are you talking about PJ Masks?
PJ Masks, there you go. Why couldn't I think of that name? I don't know why. Anyway, PJ Masks.
So everybody wants the Gecko?
Everybody wanted Gecko last year. Even for Halloween, everybody wanted Gecko for Halloween costume. But the other two characters were just left there on the shelf. Nobody wanted to be them.
Dang. It sucks to be those other characters.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, but if you've been a kid and wanted like a super popular toy, and your parents were one of those parents just to go and find it and get it for you, this is the movie for you because it just fits it to the T. Blue light specials at Kmart back in the day, you know. Like the Black Friday sales, like all that stuff, you know, trying to find that one elusive thing. That's the movie for you. Jingle All the Way. Mm-hmm. Okay, what we got next?
Next up, Ernest Saves Christmas.
Bam.
Ernest Saves Christmas. Great. That was my homie. Used to watch Ernest every Saturday.
What are you talking about, Vern?
Yeah. Ernest had a special for every, like, holiday season.
Man.
Ernest Scared Stupid was a good one for Halloween.
Ernest Goes to Camp was one of my favorites.
That was the best. That's what started it off.
Yeah, that was one of the great. What is my man's name? Was it Ernest?
Jim Varney.
Jim Varney. Yeah. So I guess obviously he hit him.
Yeah, he passed away a few years ago, I believe.
Yeah, that's pretty sad. Ernest went to Africa. Ernest went to jail.
Ernest Goes to Jail was pretty dope too.
Yeah, that was funny. Ernest went to the army. Let's see here. Hey Vern, it's Ernest. Ernest went to school. Ernest had his greatest hits. Let's see here. What else? He was slam dunking, so he played basketball back in the day.
Yep.
And then let's see here. Man, Ernest had a lot of great movies. Let's just say that. Jim Varney, you know, was great. He was one of those character actors that was super quirky, and you know, he was he didn't hit it as big as some of the other character actors you know, of his time, but you know, he still had a special place. Like he probably could have had his own, you know, variety TV show and done really, really
he
well.
Did have a TV show.
Did he really?
Yeah, it played on Saturdays. I remember. I can't remember the name, the exact name of it, but he did have one, and he played a whole bunch of different characters in there.
Yeah. I wish I'd have known that. I probably know what you're talking about. I just can't think of it right now.
It was a long time ago, man. Time ago.
But he was even in Toy Story. He was Slinky the dog. Like, he was in a lot of stuff, man. He was funny. He was a very funny guy. So, anyway, all right.
Cool. Next on the list, what we got? Something you just say you saw.
Yep, just watched it. Just watched the Santa Claus. So just watched that a couple days ago, and then just a little earlier, kids and I watched the Santa Claus 2 with Tim Allen. You know, where he basically initially, you know, in the first one, he accidentally kills Santa. He has to become Santa
right.
Save Christmas, and then so on and so forth. So yeah, the Santa Claus 1 was great. Santa Claus 2 wasn't a bad follow-up, even though they did it 8 years later. But yeah, the Santa Claus with Tim Allen was great.
Dope.
Now on to the next.
We got the sequel to the super popular Home Alone movie, Home Alone 2 Lost in New York. So yeah, this was a dope movie. Another dope movie, but with Macaulay Culkin. I'm not sure what he did after that. I can't remember. I think he did The Good Son and with Elijah Wood, and who knows what else came after that. Yeah. But yeah, this was a good movie. You know, I found it. It still baffles my mind. This kid, you know, goes to New York, abandoned house, and he just comes up with the master plan. That's like some MIT scholarship type thinking right there.
Exactly. You know what's so crazy about this movie, like, it was a sequel, right? Macaulay Culkin was such a huge star, right? After Home Alone 1, the budget for this movie was $18 million, right? Estimated $18 million, right? Opening weekend it made $31 million, right?
Wow.
This was like Thanksgiving weekend, you know, opening week. It's a sequel, by the way. Worldwide, it made $358 million.
Wow. I want to see that paycheck.
Like, in America was what, $173 million. So, still, worldwide, though, he almost doubled that worldwide. Like, that's crazy time. And it's a sequel. I couldn't even... It's just amazing. It's just amazing to see that. So you know, sadly, Macaulay Culkin, you know, his life right after, you know, right after all this stardom, all this fame, you know, just as a lot of childhood actors, you know, didn't really go as planned. But I think he, what did he do more recently? For some reason, I saw him in the news, and it wasn't like for a bad thing.
I think he got engaged or something. Was he engaged? Got engaged or something.
He's in the Jim Gaffigan show not long ago. He did a bunch of stuff with Robot Chicken. Let's see here. I'm trying to think what else. Just some other random things that, you know, not many of us have heard of. But it looks like he has a movie in post-production right now called Changeland. So
cool.
So, dope. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know if he got married more recently, but hopefully, you know. Sounds like he got his life back in order, so...
Good. Just
whatever.
Great.
We shall
great,
see. Great, great. We shall see. Anyway, all right, cool. Well, this next one, oh boy, this is like a Christmas classic all the way back from childhood. Rudolph.
Speaking of Robot Chicken.
Yeah, right? Speaking of Robot Chicken and claymation, and I always used to think it was crazy how, like, this claymation was sort of like fuzzy. Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer from 1964.
Wow.
Yukon Cornelius, the Bumble.
Man, this movie here, I'm amazed that it still can play. I could still watch this movie and you know, still have that like childlike fascination with this type of animation and stuff.
Yeah, Rudolph was a great movie, man, and I have like a box set that came with Rudolph, then it had like Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer 2 or something like that. Then there was like the Santa Claus, which was the story of the Santa Claus from there. Frosty the Snowman. And then also the Little Drummer Boy. And all of them are claymations. It's pretty stinking amazing. You know, how well they did with all of those movies. And yeah, it's just one of those childhood favorites that every year Christmas time you got to crack it, you know, got to break it out so everybody can watch it.
Yes, indeed.
It just go down in history like that. All right, cool. What's next on?
All right, next up we have Charlie Brown Christmas. Okay. I mean, what more can you say? It's Charlie Brown, Snoopy, Woodstock. You know, I always loved that little kid at the dances that did that one little dance. I don't know his name, but dude was getting down, man.
I know, tell me, like his little head was bobbing and stuff.
Yeah, his head was bobbing and his feet was just going with it, bro.
Yeah, I don't know his name either.
I don't know his name. He's just that random kid.
It wasn't Linus. It wasn't Linus.
No, not Linus.
Pigpen was always interesting.
He's the little dirty guy.
Yeah, because he was always super dirty, and
it's like his parents didn't care.
Yeah, I mean, Pigpen was like Kenny from South Park.
There you go.
That it made me sad for Pigpen, but I mean, I didn't feel sad enough that I wanted him to go take a shower. I just felt sad that he was always dirty, and no one seemed to care. Like, no one really truly ever noticed that Pigpen was dirty.
Yeah, like that is true. Like, you know who used to confuse me?
What's that?
Peppermint Patty.
Yeah.
For the longest time, I thought it was a boy.
Yeah. Because she had a deeper than a girl voice.
Yeah. And, you know, it just kind of, yeah, just confused me. And why did she always call Charlie Brown sir?
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, it's one of those questions.
It is a thing to make you go, She always called him, but wait, no, she called him Chuck. There's the other girl who called him sir.
Oh, yeah, you're right. Name. Okay.
I can't remember her name. Anyway.
Sally. Yeah.
Sally.
No, yeah, Sally.
Sally. I don't know. Anyway, yeah, I think that's right. But yeah, it was always weird. And then Lucy.
No, yeah, it was Lucy that used to call him. Sally was...
No, Lucy was the one who always used to pull the football from him. Am I right?
I don't remember, man. It's been so long. The last time I watched the Charlie Brown type show was the 3D animated one that came out a couple years ago. And then I don't even remember that one. Yeah, I think it's too late. Marcy, that's who it was. They used to say sir all the time.
Yes. I don't know, sir. Called her sir.
Called her sir. Called even Peppermint Patty, sir.
Yeah, that was so weird. Why? Why, man? Why was Peppermint Patty like that? Was Peppermint Patty, you know, before her time? You know what I'm saying?
She could have been.
But I think she always liked Charlie Brown, too. So
We don't know.
We'll never know. Things that make you go, All right, cool. Enough of Charlie Brown. Yeah. Okay. I started watching the sequel of this just the other day. Mm-hmm. Bad Santa. Billy Bob Thornton. Bernie Mac. That little black dude who's the midget. Can't remember his name.
Tony Cox.
Hey, shout out to Just in Time Podcast because they had a little people showdown. Fight showdown, and Tony Cox was one of them. I'm sorry, not one of them, but one of the people in the fight. Say it like that. Lauren Graham was in it, who my wife loves from Gilmore Girls. John Ritter. Man.
Yeah, this was a definite surprise back when it came out. Mm-hmm. You know, can't say enough about it. But
I do remember when Bad Santa came out because people were thinking, oh, it's Billy Bob Thornton. You know, he's like an Academy Award nominated or winning actor. I can't remember. Yeah, funny man Bernie Mac. Oh, this is going to be a great little buddy comedy type of thing.
Oh, no.
It went way off the deep end.
Yep.
And parents were outraged that they brought their kid to see that.
All right. Crazy.
But I mean, if I'm not correct, I'm pretty sure it was rated R.
It was. Yeah, it was. It was. Yeah. Yes, indeed. All right, what we got next?
Ooh.
A favorite of you and mine both. So. Oh,
yeah. Woodland Critter Christmas. You know, from South Park. You know, so there was this point in time when, you know, we just watched a whole bunch of South Park. I mean, I don't know how much you still watch now, but it was classic. One of those things. Yeah. It was just one of those things. This is a classic episode. It was like season 8 or something like that of South Park. They decided to do a Christmas special, and Stan, he decided to help a group of woodland critters by killing a mountain lion, only to discover that he's helping them give birth to the Antichrist. And, you know, at the end of one of their songs, they're like, "Hail Satan." And it's like, wait, what?
Yeah. Blood orgy.
They had the blood orgy. They had Deary the deer. You know, they had the baby
lion. Porcupine, the porcupine.
Woodpeckery, the woodpecker. Foxy, the fox.
Barry, the bear.
Yes. All of our favorites were there.
Wow.
Man. Raccoony, the raccoon. Beavery, the beaver. Rabbity, the rabbit. There's so many great characters that Trey Parker and Matt Stone came up with. You know, on top of Chef being in there and all the rest of the other characters. The Woodland Critter Christmas. If you haven't seen it, please find it on YouTube or somewhere. It's hilarious.
Oh, man. All right. Next up, we got one of my favorites, The Boondocks, Huey Freeman Christmas. Yes, indeed. And if you don't know The Boondocks, you are slipping. You're tripping, man. So pretty much a quick synopsis. Riley Freeman, the youngest of the Freemans, got a beef with Santa because Santa didn't bring him his toy some Christmases ago. So, he's about to take it out on Santa in the mall, and he did. He hit Santa across the head with the golf club and all kind of shenanigans. But, yeah, it's definitely a great, great show back in the day. I'm so sad that it got taken off the air, or they just didn't do it anymore. But yeah, it's a great comic strip too, for anybody that used to read the comic strip back in the day. But yeah, Boondocks, Huey Freeman Christmas.
I mean, if you could just imagine, you know, being in like a middle class or higher or whatever school, and your teacher, your white teacher, allowing you to produce an Afrocentric Christmas play. Just imagine that. And if you went like, you know, full black, you know what I'm saying? You didn't sugarcoat it, you know what I'm saying? It was a really funny episode. Matter of fact, I might watch that tonight before I go to bed. All right, let's see here. Ooh,
Batman Returns.
Batman with, like, I would have to say, the most beautiful female villain in the history of comics. At least to that point. Or at least the comic movies. I know to that point and pretty close to this point.
Yeah.
Save for Gal Gadot. I don't know.
Yeah, Michelle Pfeiffer did a thing as Catwoman.
Man, Michelle Pfeiffer. Mm. Danny DeVito was like a really creepy, like, penguin.
Yeah.
Michael Keaton, you know, as Batman.
Yes, it was.
Still one of my top two Batman of all time. So.
Yeah. Yeah, him and Bale. The other guys could...
Christian Bale, yeah.
Kick rocks. Even though I can vaguely remember the Val Kilmer version. Which one was that?
Which one was he? He was
in the one right after this.
Yeah.
And then George Clooney came, but I can vaguely remember the Val Kilmer version.
It's because it sucked. That's why.
I don't think it sucked. It didn't suck until George Clooney came in the picture.
Well, that was Bat Nipples and the Bat Credit Card.
Yeah.
Those are the things that made that suck. Oh, and Jim Carrey. Oh, and Poison Ivy. Oh, and the fact that it was terrible. So, I don't know.
Wow.
That was, let's see here. That wasn't Batman for, that was Batman Forever, wasn't it?
Batman Forever,
because that's when you had.
Was that the one with Val Kilmer? That was the one with Val Kilmer. Well, maybe that one did suck.
Yep. Okay. No, Jim Carrey was on that one. That's my
okay.
Jim Carrey was on that one, because it was Jim Carrey. It was, what's her bucket? Alicia Silverstone. Am I right?
Was she in that one?
Drew Barrymore. Came. Who am I talking about? Drew Barrymore.
What the heck?
Alicia Silverstone was when the one with bat nipples. That was the one with George.
I remember that. Yeah, she was the one with bat nipples.
So this was Val Kilmer. Tommy Lee Jones was Two-Face. Jim Carrey was the Riddler. Let's see. Nicole Kidman was the girl in this one. Chris O'Donnell was Robin on this one. And that makes me so sad, because I used to like Chris O'Donnell, but apparently after Chris O'Donnell did this part, like, you've never heard of him again.
Right.
he disappeared. I don't know what happened. Drew Barrymore was sugar in it. And Debbie Mazar was spice, sugar and spice. Yeah, so that was Val Kilmer one. But, you know, we're not talking about that crappy one with the Riddler.
Okay.
With his crazy costume. You know, it's odd. I'm just thinking about this. Jim Carrey played at least three green characters. He played the Grinch. He mm-hmm. played the Riddler. And then he played, what's his
the
name?
Mask.
The Mask. Isn't that crazy? He just liked green.
Maybe so.
Okay, guys. Batman Returns. Michael Keaton. Michelle Pfeiffer in a hot Catwoman outfit. Go and check it out.
Yes, indeed. Next up, we got Die Hard. And yes, it's a Christmas movie, people. Mm-hmm. You know, there's been some debate. It doesn't have that Christmas spirit that people maybe want, but it took place at Christmas. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to consider it a Christmas movie. Yeah. And it starred Bruce Willis, mm-hmm. Alan Rickman, he was a great villain in there.
Yep.
And a special guest, Carl Winslow. Reginald Vale Johnson.
Yes, indeed.
So, yeah. And he was he was just as well Carl Winslow. You may as well just call him Officer Winslow in here, because he's the same exact person. Lent all kind of great wisdom to people, and you know. So, yeah, Die Hard, man. I got to check it out before Christmas comes this year.
Did you ever have the Die Hard video game for the Nintendo, or did you ever play it?
I remember it. I do remember it, I think.
Man, it was a very bad game.
I'm sure it was.
1990. It came out in 1990 after the movie came out in 88. It's nuts, man, because that movie came out in 88. The video game didn't come out for 2 years later. And nowadays, you have the video game releasing before the movie. Sort of like Battlefront did. You know what I'm saying?
That's right.
Or same, you know, same weekend as the movie, something like that. But I mean, that was also a time where you had to wait like a year before it came out on video. Mm-hmm. So, wow, times had changed. All right, cool. So next, I know this is definitely, you know, one of your favorites, one of mine as well. Elf.
Yes, indeed. Elf, starring Will Ferrell. You know, it was a pretty cool movie. You know, I like it. Kids like it too. We got it on DVD. And they're playing it right now. Well, not actually playing it now, but you know, you go on the channel and you'll see it being streamed and stuff. But yeah, Elf.
Will Ferrell, James Caan,
yeah,
Bob Newhart, a lot of great great actors. Zoe Deschanel,
yeah, that's right.
Faison Love,
yes indeed. Yeah. Yeah.
Peter Dinklage, another person who was in the Little Man fight for Justin Time. So yeah, a lot of fun people. And do you remember what Elf? You actually remember what Elf ate? Like what his favorite Christmas meal was?
I don't remember.
Okay, so spaghetti.
Okay.
With M&Ms. Top with syrup.
Gotcha.
Spaghetti, M&M's, and syrup. That was his favorite Christmas meal. And we actually thought about, somebody actually thought about making that for our Christmas party potluck.
Nice.
Thankfully, nobody did, but we wanted to at least have it like in a bowl on the side, you know, just to like give a little elf thing, you know, a little elf callback Easter egg, but nobody did it. They didn't pull the trigger. But yeah, Elf was funny, especially the snowball fight that he had, and he was like shooting like quadruple time cannons,
mm-hmm.
Snowballs hitting everybody. So that was pretty dope. All right, cool.
All right.
So next up, we have the movie Scrooged.
Scrooge.
Bill Murray.
That's right. Scrooge with Bill Murray. It's like a what's that movie? Damn it! Why am I drawing a blank? Not The Nightmare Before Christmas. Ebenezer Scrooge. What was that movie?
Christmas Carol.
God dang, man, what is wrong with me? Yeah, so it's like a modern day version of the Christmas Carol, even though this took place in like late 80s, early 90s, something like that. But yeah, definitely a good movie, fun movie. I think sometimes a lot of people skip over it, but It was pretty funny. Bill Murray, man. Bill Murray's always fun to watch. Yeah. So, yes, indeed. So, yeah. Scrooge, yeah. Whatever number Bill that Murray. Was. We don't know.
Yeah, that was number 10. So, yeah, now we're down into the top 10, guys. That was number 10. So, number 9 is an old favorite. And basically...
just talked about it.
Yeah, we literally just talked about this movie. This is a book that you probably read a lot as kids growing up. You know, your kids are probably hearing it now in the schools. You may read this to your kids at night to sleep, because sometimes we do, even though the book by Dr. Seuss is long. It is How the Grinch Stole Christmas. And we go live action and animated on this one. They both tied for number 9.
Mm-hmm. That's right. All right. Number 8.
Number 8. Muppet Christmas. Speaking of this, yeah.
Muppet Christmas Carol. It's been a minute since I've seen a Muppet Christmas Carol, but yeah, I'm going to have to try and find that and have the kids watch it.
Yeah, I mean, the Muppet Christmas Carol is just one of those movies. It's just like, you know, just like, it's like you said, every year you gotta
watch it. Yeah, you gotta watch it, you know.
It's just one of those movies that's, I don't know. It's one of those movies that's funny. It's goofy because it's the Muppets, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But you know, it's still the same old Christmas Carol. So, yeah, I think, I love that movie. Kermit the Frog, Miss Piggy, Fuzzy. Who is your favorite Muppet?
Dang, who was my favorite Muppet? God, that's a good question. There's a couple that comes to mind. I like... Sometimes I like Fonzo. I love Animal. Animal's dope. Mm-hmm. Who was that one bear that played the drums? Was he a bear?
Was that Rolf?
Rolf? Was he a dog? Maybe he was a dog. Why do I think... I'm thinking Fonzie?
Fuzzy.
Fuzzy? Shucks.
Fuzzy the bear. Rolf was
a
dog.
Yeah, Rolf was the dog. I used to like Rolf.
Yeah, that's
Rolf
pretty good.
And Animal yeah. And Rolf.
This is my question though, because Rolf always seemed like he was a brother, right? He always seemed
Fozzie
like
Bear.
A little more black than everybody else.
Yeah.
So why they make him brown? Like, was it true? Was he the brother of the Muppets?
Maybe so. I remember Muppet Babies.
Yeah, Muppet Baby. Yeah, I definitely remember Rolf, and I love him. My favorite was Gonzo though. Gonzo was crazy.
Yeah, Gonzo. He was crazy, man.
He was. He looked the craziest, and he always did the most crazy things. So, excuse me, Gonzo was my guy. All right, well, here comes another movie that we loved way back in the day. Oh my gosh, The Gremlins.
Gremlins, yes, indeed. My kids are, I won't say they're scared to watch Gremlins, but you know, when they start to transform into the Gremlins and not the little Mogwai. You know, then they get a little freaked out. But, you know, I used to love this movie, of course. I don't know when this came out. Probably when I was 6 or 7.
84. How old were you in 84?
Never mind. I was only probably 3 or 4. I probably just didn't see it until I was like 7.
Yeah, you probably didn't see it until
it was out on. Because I didn't go to the theater to watch this. And I'm sure... they weren't releasing movies as quickly as they were back then as they are now. Well, there was no DVD, there was VHS. So, yeah. I don't know how long that took to get out.
I definitely remember watching Gremlins on VHS at home. I know we rented it from the local movie rental store. This was before Blockbuster even. And for all you people who don't know what a rental store is, you could go to Netflix right now and watch movies. Well, back in the day, you know, you'd actually have to go to a building
physically
that had cassette tapes, VHS cassette tapes with all these movies. A lot of times they weren't rewound, meaning, you know, you'd have to sit there, put it into your VCR, video, cassette, recorder, and, you know, play the movie that way instead of, you know, just streaming it. Like you can just pull it up now on your phone. So check this out. So the budget for Gremlins was $11 million, right? Opening weekend, it made just more than that. It made $12.5 million opening weekend. And then USA gross 1980, 1984, USA gross made $148 million. So, like, nowadays, that's probably, what, like, three, four times that amount if you bump up for inflation. But, yeah, man, back in the day, a $150 million movie was, like, a big, huge hit.
Yeah.
It was. So crazy. So, let's see. They made Gremlins 1, 2, and 3, right?
Yes.
So...
Wait, no, just Gremlins 1 and 2.
1 and 2, okay. So if they made a Gremlins 3, because I already know they're bringing out a Beetlejuice 2, or Beetlejuice 3, or how many ever Beetlejuices it is, would you go watch it? Or would you pause?
I might have to pause. That trailer really going to have to sell me. They really going to have to sell it in the trailer. If it's like a remake, I don't know. Probably not, because they're going to CGI it all up. It's not going to be have the same type of realistic effect.
Animatronic effects, yeah.
Yeah, they're not going to have that, you know. So, I don't know. I'd probably have to pause until the first reviews come out.
Mm-hmm. I would definitely wait until it came on Netflix. Sorry. I love you, Maguas, but I'd wait for you then. All right, number six. We talked about number two. The sequel of this earlier,
Home Alone,
with the crazy box office, yeah, Home Alone. So,
yep, pretty much
Macaulay
the same.
Culkin's debut.
Same for man. Yeah, I'll tell you one thing. Mm-hmm. That kid was my kid, and he talked to my wife that way.
Man,
he would have got smacked so hard.
He would have got left on purpose.
he would have got left on purpose, man. They would have to call child service support services on me. No.
Yeah, so
I'm surprised that mama let her get away with it.
Yeah, that was, you know, she was soft. But yeah, man, so this is when Macaulay Culkin's debut. 8-year-old troublemaker must protect his house from a pair of burglars when he's accidentally left at home by his family during a Christmas vacation. And oh, by the way, his family was like on their way to France, so they didn't even realize it until they were like, what?
Yeah, in the air.
In the air on the airplane halfway to France. Yeah, and it was like everybody on their street was gone, for Christmas. So there was nobody who could really get in contact with him. It was a pretty dope movie. You remember Keep the Change, You Filthy Animal with the pizza guy coming. It was very funny. It was always one of those things in the 80s and 90s. You know, they had movies where. They showed kids like the Goonies. You know, they showed kids making all these like crazy gadgets or obstacle courses or like just doing silly, like booby trap style things. And this was one of those movies. You know, he had like the bowling ball that he had rigged, you know, to knock out the one burglar. He had the glass that he had broken on the stairway. Like there was so many things.
Yeah.
So. Okay, so earlier, right? Maybe this is a little less impressive now, because earlier I talked about the budget for Home Alone 2, which was $18 million. Home Alone 1, also $18 million. Opening weekend, they didn't quite make that $18 million. They made $17 million. So Gross USA, they made $285 million, right?
That's a come up.
That's a big come up, right? The gross worldwide, $533.
Man, come on.
So I'm sure obviously
Macaulay Culkin probably still eating off the first Home Alone.
I don't know, man. You know, I hope he's not broke. I just hope he's not broke. I hope he's making money off of that.
So
crazy. All right, cool. Well, that was 25 to number 6. So now we're going to talk about number 5. And I don't know if our top 5 are really in a specific order, just because we love all these movies so much. So don't hate on us when you hear this movie at number 5.
Yeah, number 5. I love it. Friday After Next, you know, I thought it was one. I ain't gonna say it was the better one out of the Friday movies, but it definitely was a funny one. Introduced us to the second one, Next Friday, introduced us to Day Day.
Yeah,
but
right.
the third one introduced us to Friday After Next. Introduced us to Damon, which was
Terry Crews.
Dang it. What's going on?
Terry Crews.
So I was tired. Yeah. Third one introduced us to Damon, who was played by Terry Crews. And it introduced us to a very young Cat Williams.
Yeah.
As Money Mike.
Man.
So Cat Williams, Terry Crews, you know, we got those two. And, well, I ain't gonna say it introduced us to Ricky Smiley, but Ricky Smiley was in there and he played a crackhead. Yeah. You know? So
that was probably one of his larger roles that he had.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I guess the black community knew about him because of, you know, Comic View on BET.
Right.
And he was actually doing radio. He was doing like morning radio too at the hip hop station there in Dallas Fort Worth area, which I thought was funny. But yeah, I mean, people sort of knew who he was, but, you know, he hadn't really done, you know, anything big. He hadn't done any movies up to that point. Friday After Next was his first movie. And then, you know, he was in First Sunday. He was in Stomp the Yard too. You know, he was in quite a few, Baggage Claim, you know, a few after that. So,
right.
Yeah. So Ricky Smiley. But yeah, anyway, man, it was funny. You know, you had, it was the third movie in the Friday franchise. Ice Cube still going strong, you know, still one of my favorite rapper actors. I think I call them like the best rapper actor in my opinion, just because of the way that he changed from being, you know, California hood, you know, and into a comedy actor. So yeah, mm-hmm. So I thought it was funny. But yeah, Mike Epps, also Day Day, who made his reappearance from the second one. John Witherspoon, you know, still just as funny as ever.
Pops,
you know, Pops from the first one. Man, there's so many funny people in there, but yeah, that movie was one of those movies. It'll go down in time, you know, as one of the better Friday movies. Top Flight Security of the world. And honestly, I'd have to say, I like Friday After Next better than Friday Number Two, Next Friday.
Yeah, yeah, of course, I do too.
It was definitely better.
I do too. Yeah. Anyway, so, all right, what do we got next? We got a few more left. Next,
A Christmas Story.
Classic. Forever a classic. Mm-hmm. You know, Christmas Day, they played this 24 hours straight on TBS. So you know how classic that got to be played on TBS for 24 hours. But yeah, so many classic moments in this movie. You know, from the kid saying, "Oh, fudge," mm-hmm. even though he didn't say that word.
Ralphie.
Yeah, Ralphie, he didn't say that word as he described the leg lamp, which has become mm-hmm. classic and is being sold numerous places.
I love lamp.
The whole saying fragile, you know, yeah. It must be Italian. So yeah, I still say that when I'm opening boxes and stuff. So yeah, it's a definite classic. And if you hadn't seen this movie, man, I'd have no clue where you've been.
Yeah, yeah, Christmas Story, man. I didn't see this as a kid in the theaters, but I know I definitely saw it many times afterward.
Oh yeah,
it came out in 1983. Wow.
Oh yeah, yeah. Definitely can't remember that if I went to see it.
1983. Let's see here. So I know I was about five. Let me see when this movie actually dropped. November 18th. So yeah, my sister was 10 days old when this came out.
Oof.
So, I was 5 in about 3 weeks. That's how old I was. So I wasn't doing anything but helping out at that point. But mm-hmm. yeah, the leg lamp, which is one of the best gag gifts now. If you give somebody a leg lamp, in any form, is great. You know, this is also one of those things where you learn to never lick metal in the snow.
Oh yeah. I told my kids not to do that.
And it hurts. It hurts so bad. There's so many great moments in this movie. Yeah, it was just greatness. All right, cool. So let's see here. Down to number three. And this one, Jay, I know it has a special place in your heart.
Definitely a special place in my heart. Oh, excuse me. Always loved this movie. 1993, The Nightmare Before Christmas. Mm-hmm. You know, stop motion animation, Tim Burton. You already know what it looks like because of Beetlejuice and all his other movies that he did. You know, Jack Skellington, you know, Halloween Town. Of course, I won't go into a big synopsis, but classic characters. You get all the characters from, you know, I ain't gonna say all the characters from your favorite holidays, but, you know, they talk about Christmas. They talk about Halloween because it's Halloween Town. And Jack wants to be Santa Claus, even though he doesn't bring the gifts that Santa Claus usually brings. Mm-hmm. They're more a little bit horrifying. So, yeah, check that out if you didn't check it out. It's a dope movie. Will yes, forever indeed. Be a classic.
Yes, indeed. And I'm going to just drop on there. When we went to Disneyland back in September, they had actually decked out the park in Halloween decoration, right? Leading up to October. So they have this ride there called the Haunted Mansion. It's, you know, one of the more popular rides at all the Disney's. Always has the longest wait time to get in. Mm-hmm. So we went to check it out, and they actually had the Nightmare Before Christmas inside the Haunted Mansion. So everything was themed from the Nightmare Before Christmas, all the characters, animatronics, everything. It was pretty dope. So that's a fun movie. And then on top of that, we actually went to, California Adventure, which is like Hollywood Studios, you know, like a Universal Studios version for Disney. And we actually did an art class there. My daughter wanted to go to art class where they teach you how to draw. And the character that we drew was Sally. So one of the Disney animators actually taught us how to draw Sally from Nightmare.
Nice. Awesome.
So we still have those drawings. So it's very cool and very interesting, way that the animators drew those characters and, you know, how they just how they did it. It was pretty amazing. So special place in my heart too. All right, cool. So number two, oh man, this movie, this movie that, you know, when you think of the word vacation, you know, especially if you're a child of the 80s, you think Chevy Chase, you think Shenanigans, you think a bunch of craziness and National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation, was one of those, it was one of those movies with Chevy Chase where, you know, he basically has the whole family, his wife's family, his family, whatever, over his house, for Christmas time. And he's one of those guys that sort of has to keep up with the Joneses and try to do better. So he tries to basically, you know, make his, I guess, put enough Christmas lights on his house, you know, to where you can see it from outer space.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Okay.
I thought she was still saying something.
I'm dead. No, yeah. Keep going. Go ahead.
Yeah, man. So I try to do that too, but yeah, he tries to please everybody in his own way. You know, he takes his kids out, tries to give them all the Christmas spirit, takes his kids out to the middle of nowhere to try and get a tree. Mm-hmm. You know, they chop a fresh tree down and bring it back. Just to not have it fit correctly in their living room.
It's way too big.
Yeah. Yeah, man. It's definitely a great movie. Randy Quaid's character, who is Ellen, his wife's... Let's see, his wife's... I'm trying to think of the association. His wife's sister. So his brother-in-law. Is that right? I'm trying to think of the relation. Yeah. Anyway, he's just always, there's something wrong in his head, you know, because he pulls up there with his kids in their RV, you know, and he just makes himself at home. Didn't get invited, but he just came. He just showed up at the doorstep, you know.
But yeah, it's so funny.
Great movie.
It's a great movie. And I have a question, you know, speaking of the tree. That they had in there, and especially a really funny scene where, there was like a squirrel that flew out of the tree and attacked Chevy Chase. I thought it was great. Did you ever have a tree as a kid? Did y'all ever have a tree that was too big for your house?
No, man, we had fake trees. We never did buy a real tree.
That's true. I remember that.
Never in a minute. We kept the same tree from when I was little until I was about maybe a teenager, maybe in my mid teens. And all the little bristles and stuff started falling off. Mm-hmm. So it's just this bare tree. Looked like it was sick and diseased and just nasty looking.
Yep. I remember one year we went out for a tree. And I remember my mom and dad saying, all right, this is the tree that we're going to get. I was like, all right, cool. And then they walked away to go pay for it. And they're like, Jared, just stay here. and, you know, make sure that the guys, you know, who come and get the tree or who come in to get the tree to trim it and cut off the bottom, you know, to put the stand on it, make sure they pick the right, you know, they pull the right tree. So I stood there by the tree, and I do distinctly remember this one Christmas tree leaning up against it, you know, leaning up against one of the other trees they had at this tree, tree place that we had. So it was just leaning there. So the guys came and they're like, which tree is it? And I was like, it's this tree. So, you know, they picked it, they cut it, put it on the car. We got that sucker home. And if you remember my house back in the day, there was sort of like a 10-foot, you know, sort of middle, I guess 10-foot like apex or whatever area in the living room. That tree, Jay, that tree, it had to be about, okay, no, that archway went up probably about 12 feet. I'm wrong. So that tree had to be about 8 or 9 feet. It was huge. My mom and dad, they swear up and down that they picked like a 6 to 7 foot tree.
You told them the wrong
like,
one.
Jared, they're like, Jared, you told them the wrong tree. I was like, no, that's the right tree. That's the same one that was leaning up against the tree. That was the one that y'all pointed to. That's the right tree. That's the one. And they still, my mom still to this day will say that I picked the wrong tree. But nah, I contend that it was the right tree. And this was a huge tree. And I mean, we didn't have enough ornaments for the tree. That's how big it was.
Dang, that's crazy. Well, at least y'all got a tree, a bigger tree for less money.
Yeah.
More tree for the amount you paid for it.
More tree for the amount you paid for it, yes.
All right.
That was cool. All right, cool. So now we're down to number
one. Last one. Trading Places.
Yep.
I mean, what more can you say about it? Dan Aykroyd. Eddie Murphy, you know, a slew of other people, Jamie Lee Curtis.
I was going to say Julia Lewis, and I was like, wait, that's not right. Jamie Lee Curtis.
Yeah, Jamie Lee Curtis, and she showed off her assets. Anyway, yeah, that always made a little guy, I mean, it always made me feel special, special places.
Make a little guy feel special.
Yeah, you know. Yeah, I don't know. When did this movie come out? Like 83 too. Another 83 year.
You know, this is what's crazy about this movie. It came out in June of 1983, yet it's considered a Christmas movie.
Yeah.
Obviously, because it was set, you know, it was set
Christmas
time. But it came out in June. Isn't that wild?
It is. That's pretty interesting.
And let me just say this. Okay, so we already heard Home Alone had an $18 million budget. This movie had a $15 million budget. Opening weekend in America, in June, mind you, it made $7 million. This is summertime. This is back when people were off for the full 3 months of summer. But gross, it did $90
million. Okay, that ain't bad at all.
So it came up, but it took a while.
Yeah, it's all good.
Yes, indeed. But if you don't know the synopsis of this movie, quick synopsis: a snobbish investor and a wily street con artist find their positions reversed, a role reversal, as part of a bet by two callous millionaires. So, it was a great movie, man. Mortimer and Randolph.
Yeah.
I'll always remember. Yeah. What was that? I'm sorry.
Oh no, I was going to say it's pretty funny how they made a reappearance in Coming to America.
Oh yeah, yeah, and playing the same characters. Great. I'll always remember Dan Aykroyd with his Santa Claus suit on, pulling out that big, huge smoked salmon and eating it. Like I always sort of wanted to try that fuzzy smoked salmon.
Wow.
You know,
that's great.
I looked at it and I was like, that smoked salmon actually looks really good, even though it has like Santa Claus fur on it.
Oh man. Yeah. What was your favorite part in that movie?
It would definitely be where Dan Aykroyd, Jamie Lee Curtis, and Eddie Murphy were in the train or whatever they were driving, riding in the train.
Merry New Year.
Yeah, and then Eddie Murphy's like, Merry New Year. That was great.
Would you like some beef jerky?
weirdest thing ever. And then they had the gorilla, like the guy in the gorilla suit. Obviously, it was a dude in a gorilla suit, but the real gorilla, mm-hmm. who also looked like a guy in a gorilla suit, you know, was trying to hit. So I thought that was really funny. That was one of my favorite scenes. And then also Eddie Murphy riding around on like the little caster cart in the road. It's just funny. I'll just always remember those. What about you, man?
Yeah, I was going to say the same thing. When they were in the train, that was my favorite part of the movie towards the end of it.
One of the best.
Yeah. That, wow. Well, even the part where Eddie Murphy was in the jail talking about all his money and stuff and saying how he got a limo outside and he got a phone in the limo and then... Mm-hmm. Two big guys wanted to rough him up inside the jail cell. Yeah. So, yeah, and he always said that. Yeah, well, one of the guys said that. So, yeah, it was a good movie, man. I'm gonna have to introduce my kids to that. I'm sure they'll. They may like it. They may like it. They may not. They can't sit still for anything. So, yeah.
I know.
So that was a 25 movies, dang. And there were a lot more. Like I wanted to put the California Raisins Christmas special, but. Mm-hmm. It wasn't really a Christmas special dedicated to California Raisins. They just made an appearance. Yeah, there's a lot of other things.
Lots of other things. We could have talked about all these movies, but that would have made the episode even longer.
Yes.
So we just tried to give quick hits on a few of those as we went through. And yeah, man, what do you think of our list? You know, would you add some? Would you delete some? What would you add to your Christmas list? Should we have added any honorable mentions like that California Raisin special?
I mean, there's like a few. I mean, I think the Guardians probably could have been up there. It was okay. I mean, my kids like it. I thought it was a decent movie. I mean, it had Christmas element. I guess it took place around Christmas time. You know, so it
Rise of the Guardians?
Yeah, Rise of the Guardians.
Dog,
you didn't like
I was
it.
Never a fan of that one.
Oh, man.
We went and saw that with my kids, and I'm going to tell you what, man. That was the first movie, and mind you, my kids, let's see, Jackson was 4 and Savannah was 2, but that was the first movie
they didn't like
that the kids did not pay attention to.
That's crazy.
At all. And, you know, we had taken them to see movies before, mm-hmm. so it's not like the first time. But yeah, that was the first movie that they did not pay attention to at all, and I was like, wow, really? Okay. It was all right for me, but, you know, then again, it may be somebody's favorite, so who knows?
Yeah, that's true.
True. So, you know, there's quite a few that we missed. You know, there's quite a few that we could have added in there. But hey, we didn't. We didn't.
Yeah.
What would you add?
I don't know.
That's the question.
Somebody let us know. Call us. Text us. Leave us a comment in this episode. What would you add? What would you take out? Better yet, don't even say what you take out. Just tell us what you'd add. Yeah. We're going to leave that right there.
Christmas, you know?
Yeah.
I want to know.
Wow. It's getting late.
Yes, it is. All right, cool. Well, okay. So things that make you go, So we didn't really recap this. We haven't really recapped this yet, but this past week on Instagram, we had a One's Gotta Stay for sidekicks, right? Not side pieces, but sidekicks. Side pieces will be on another show. Let's see here. So. One's Gotta Stay, sidekicks, between Boo Boo from Yogi Bear, Luigi from Super Mario Brothers, Pinky of Pinky and the Brain, and Patrick Star from SpongeBob. So Jay, who's gotta go, or who's gotta stay, I guess?
Luigi, no doubt.
Yep.
No doubt about it, man. He's he never fumbles up. He always cleans up Mario's mess. Mm-hmm. I mean, even though Mario is the hero, I always felt like Luigi would come in. He'd pick up the slack that Mario couldn't do. You know, he could jump higher, run faster.
Yeah.
So yeah, Luigi got to stay.
Funny. Yeah, I definitely had to go with Luigi as well. You know, you couldn't do it like Jay and Brady, 360 said you couldn't do any better than Luigi. You know, the other three are cool, but you know, we got a kingdom to save. You know what I'm saying? And then like Two Squares Pod said, I'm about to go with Luigi. He about them coins. You know, got to make that money. A lot of people said Luigi was their one. A lot of people said Pinky, a.k.a. the smart one, like Just In Time, just like Darnell from Darnell's Does It. You know what I'm saying? A lot of these people thought about them. PTO Unlimited, they had a pretty interesting take. Brett said Pinky, only because he always feels smart. Josh says Luigi because he loved Nintendo. Alex says Patrick because he keep her entertained with his stupidity. But and what up, man, Pod, I think they dogged out Boo Boo. They said Boo Boo was a snitch. That's why Yogi always kept getting caught. Get his first 48 eating McDonald's in the interrogation room. Statement singing out of here immediately. Hashtag free Yogi. So they said they got a ride with Luigi. Down from day one, never went after Princess Peach behind Mario's back, and he's the shooter in Mario Kart, so I got to go with him.
Yep.
So, yes, indeed. Lots of people on the fence there. John from the John Effect said, absolutely not. All these niggas can go home. So he didn't care about any of them. But, yeah, I got to go with Luigi on that one, too, because Luigi, I mean, Mario Kart, like what a man said, he's the guy I get more than anyone else. I always ride with him. I used to want to play second when you had a first and second player.
Mm-hmm.
Play Super Mario Brothers just so I could be Luigi. I tried. I dressed up as Mario this year for Halloween, but they didn't have any Luigi. Only because they didn't have any Luigi costumes. So, yeah. Luigi, cool. Gotta stay. I want to know what y'all think out there in listener land. So now was that time where JQ's the music and we ask you to tap your love box. Christmas edition.
Tap your love box.
I was waiting for that drop.
Oh, my bad. Yeah. If you spent so much money this Christmas and you reach in your pocket, and all you hear is jingle all the way home. Tap your love box.
Nice.
Wow, that was off the cuff.
Oh, man. Wow. If you had an office Christmas party like mine, where you got to twerk while at work, tap your love box.
Nice. If your office is the type of office that'll put tequila in gin, man, in the water coolers, the water dispenser, tap your love box.
Nice. If you went to a white school and they let y'all do an Afrocentric Christmas play, tap your love box.
In blackface.
Oh,
it's a Kwanzaa Christmas. That doesn't make sense.
Oh, man. Somebody the other day asked me if I celebrate Kwanzaa. I was like, no.
Come on,
G.
Not all black people do that.
Sorry. Yeah, that was the question. If you ever had the Ghost of Christmas Past, Christmas Present, and Christmas Future visit you, and you a Scrooge, tap your love box.
And they all talk like Terrence Howard? Tap your love box. Say, man, it's the Ghost of Christmas Past, man.
If you ever wanted to see Kitten Play do a Christmas movie, a house party Christmas, tap your love box.
That would have been kind of dope.
Back in the day.
I mean, it'll have to follow the first one, because after that first one, it just kind of went downhill. This is true.
If you ever sat at home when you were a kid and tried to figure out what you would do to burglars if they ever broke into your house, like booby trapping a bowling ball to hit him in the head.
That's right.
Or hanging on to a butcher knife pretty much throughout the day, just waiting for that moment, like some kid named Jared did. Tap your love box. I mean, I was armed and ready.
Man. If you thought Rudolph was actually special.
No.
Tap your love box.
Oh, man. Why? Why you gotta say that about my boy Rudolph?
I don't know. I think he was just Maybe Santa just felt sorry for him. It was just like, hey, this one time you could fly this sleigh. It's like a make-a-wish.
That is messed up. if you're happy that Disney finally bought the rights to Fox's movies and they can finally do a proper X-Men and maybe an Avengers versus X-Men. Maybe a Spider-Man and Deadpool team up. Maybe Smashing Time with the Hulk versus the Thing. Ooh, so many options.
So
tap
many
your
options.
Love box.
Man. Goodness. That's a lot. That you is a lot. For those parents out there that bring their kids to the doctor and hear them yelling and screaming over getting shot with a needle, and you thinking to yourself, I'm glad it's not me. Tap your love box.
If you're on Instagram watching this lady from, I don't know where she came from, but her name is I'm Whoa Vicky.
Oh man, come on.
And she don't know how to spell her child's name Tyrone. T-R-Y-O-N-E. And she glue up. Tap your love box.
This
she said she had a glue up.
This girl here.
Yes, this used to be me. Yes, I glue up. And yes, I'm black.
Oh, my God. She's so bad.
And yes, I'm not taking bad, a selfie on way, top but... of a toilet inside of a public restroom.
Where do they find these people at, man?
Man, I don't know.
It's like her and Danielle. Riggle.
Come on, man. I don't know. I don't know. All that while sitting on top of a toilet in a public restroom.
Okay. On that note.
All right, cool. Everybody. Well, on that note, if you're ready for Christmas, all we got to say is, man, thank y'all for rocking with us. Blah, 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 blah. Thank y'all for rocking with us, you know, for what, a year and a half almost now. Maybe a little more than a year and a half. And yeah, listening, sharing, retweeting, following us, you know, interacting. We appreciate y'all. Man, there's too many people to name, you know, and give props to. But we definitely go back to the beginning, you know, where we had the Horror Club. We had What a Man podcast. We had B-Rob. We had Just in Time. Unwritable Rant. Golly, so many people. Nelson. And Jose at the Super Toro Bros podcast, which we haven't heard in a while. We miss those fellas. So many people way back then and so many newer people now. You know, Podcast Brothers, John Effect, all those DFW pods, Q the Great. There's so many. There's so many to even name. But yeah, thank y'all very much.
2018 is going to be a good year, an interesting year indeed. For us.
Yes, indeed.
It's going to start out. Right. It's going to start out on a good note.
A bang. That's all I got to say, man. So, yeah, so we definitely appreciate y'all. You know, Merry Christmas. Happy Hanukkah. Happy Kwanzaa. Happy Christmas, Hanukkah, Kwanzaa.
There you go.
You know?
And all those in between.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. Jay, you have anything to say?
Yeah. Merry Christmas. You can find us at Twitter and Instagram at hashtag Blackout Pod, Snapchat hashtag Bop. Listen to all these episodes on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, and SoundCloud. Email us topics, mic checks, all that good stuff at hashtag Blackout Pod @gmail.com. Or you can do the same thing at 3853BLAKPC or 3853252572. Feels like my voice is getting hoarse. Maybe my kid got me sick. Hope not.
Gotta stay away from that, man. Ooh, it's no bueno. Hopefully not.
All right.
Hopefully not. All right. Well, on that note, we blacking out. Merry Christmas.
Merry.
Have yourself a merry little Christmas. Let your heart be light. From now on,